The following content is provided under a Creative Commons license. Your support will help MIT OpenCourseWare continue to offer high-quality educational resources for free. To make a donation or to view additional materials from hundreds of MIT courses, visit MIT OpenCourseWare at ocw.mit.edu.
Okay, so you guys worked in just in time. Today's topic is slightly different, but because before we start, you asked a question last time, right?
Yeah.
And what's your name again?
Kalpesh.
Kalpesh.
Yeah.
Okay, again. So Kalpesh, my friend here, asked me a question, and I think you asked it in the lecture before the quiz, right? So I answered it. I guess he was not convinced, so he asked me again just before the quiz started. I told him, well, wait until actually the class is convinced so we can all discuss it together. So I was thinking how to answer his question, and then I decided it was a really interesting question. So I made some additional slides to discuss the topic that he asked. And these slides are not on the website, so don't look for them, you cannot find them. Even though I will probably post them anyway, but for now you just have to watch and participate in the discussion and see what happens. Okay, so Kalpesh asked the following. When I started actually the class, I claimed that optical rays have to satisfy Fermat's principle. So therefore they must always go where their path is minimal. So in the case of a green, well, I use the notation here where the gray area in the slide corresponds to high index of refraction. The sort of whitish area is lower index. So this is like a typical green. You can imagine this profile maybe quadratic or something like that. And what we said in the class, and you all believed me except for Kalpesh, I guess, what I said in the class is that if you have a ray that enters this medium sort of off-axis, like shown here, the ray will actually bend inwards, so all the rays will come to a focus somewhere around there. But Kalpesh asks, why doesn't the ray do this? I mean, the rays here seems to actually, it seems to do the wrong thing, doesn't it? It seems to go towards the high index area, whereas the minimum path principle would suggest that the ray should go outwards like this, towards the low index area. So the question is, what will the ray do? Will it do this or that? Well, we know from experience, from experiment, I should say, that green optics do focus. So we know that physics actually behaves like this. But the question is, how is that consistent with our description of the physical system? What is going on here? Okay. So that is Kalpesh's question, and what I said when he asked it in class, more or less, I cannot remember exactly what I said, but I said, well, to properly contemplate the answer, we must consider not just this ray. If we just have this ray, we don't really know where the ray will go. But we also have another ray, the one that is on axis. Now, these two rays, they actually originated at the same point. Where did they originate? Well, at infinity, right? Somewhere far out to the left over here. And what I said is that basically these rays, because this ray goes through a longer optical path because it is entering in a high index medium, this ray has to match its optical path. So this ray actually enters a lower index, so therefore it starts with a sort of a predicament that points to a smaller optical path. So in order to catch up, in order to match the longer optical path of this ray, the sort of off-axis ray, must follow a longer geometrical distance, so that the longer geometrical distance times the lower index kind of will balance, will compensate. Okay. So this is what this is where we left it. Kalpesh came back to me next, at the quiz, and he told me, well, I don't believe it. Why should it, right? You want to rephrase your question? Okay, so I represented your objection well, right? Okay. Okay, so let's find. So first of all, does anybody else from here or from Boston have some additional insight about this? I can go back to the original. We'll call it the Kalpesh question. Yes.
We didn't hear the question.
Is your button pushed? Yeah. You have to make sure that the red light is also on.
Okay. Yeah, in the standard case of an interface, we have a wave, a ray propagating from left to right, and we have an interface which is top to bottom. But in this case, the interface could be considered to be left to right, couldn't we? Because the refractive index changes from top to bottom. So the interface, I'm just thinking that if we consider the interface to be from left to right, then the normal will be from top to bottom, and still the Snell's law will lead us to the correct answer. Correct?
Yes, you can actually, by the time you reach here, where the ray has already bent, you can make that argument,
yeah.
Right? Because
yeah.
now
yeah.
the ray is really is hitting an interface.
Me. Yeah.
But the question is, why should the ray start bending inwards
yeah.
to begin
yeah.
with? Why should it not bend this way?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
if it starts bending this way, then Snell's law also said it should go like this, right? So there's yeah. something amiss here.
Yeah.
Okay. So there's no doubt, as I said, there's no doubt that the correct physics is this one. The question is our model correct? You know, is our claim, all the stuff we developed about optical paths and so on, does it really agree with the physics? Okay. So I don't hear any other comments or objections about this, or okay. So let's go with a little bit more care through this argument. What is happening? Let's take out the medium. So there's nothing now, just free space. So the rays started at infinity. They're heading towards infinity. Everybody's happy with a straight path, right? Because clearly the straight line in uniform space is the shortest between two points. And clearly these two rays, they never really meet, but we say they meet at infinity to the left, and they also meet again at infinity to the right, and they will have traversed the same optical path by the time they meet again at infinity. Now, you might ask, well, what does it really mean? I mean, after all, the path itself is infinite. What does it mean they traveled equal infinite path? Well, I can get actually around this problem pretty easily because I can actually put some boundaries to the left and to the right, and I can keep these boundaries at a finite distance, right? Then I can definitely measure the optical path. Then I can start moving the boundaries further away to the left and further away to the right. The optical paths remain the same as I move the boundaries, right? And I can continue this process until the boundaries are really, really very far. This is mathematically really what we mean by infinity, right? So I can get around this difficulty. I can certainly talk about equal paths even if the paths are actually infinite, okay? This is sort of a technicality, but nevertheless an important one. So we know that we're on solid ground. Okay. So I hope I've convinced you that Fermi is happy in this case of free space because the rays indeed propagate through the minimum path and indeed they're all equal in terms of path. Okay. Okay. Now this is really not anything new. This is what I said before, and basically this says that the longer geometrical path actually gets to be multiplied by a lower index. So therefore, by the time the rays meet again here, they still have equal optical paths, because the path to the left is equal, they both came from infinity. Then the two trajectories here, if you sort of integrate the optical path all along, you would get equal answer. Okay. Are you happy? Maybe push the button, yeah.
instead of a wave coming towards whole cross section of the green lens, suppose if we have a small spot coming towards only towards the top, so will it go towards up or in that case?
Right. So the question is, suppose I take out this ray, right? Will the ray, will this thing also focus? What do you think?
I think we have only a single ray towards the top, which is coming towards the lower refractive index. Then it should go towards the lower refractive index because it doesn't need to match the with the same phase as the central wave.
Okay, let's not quite argue about a single ray because there's no such thing as a single ray, right? If you illuminate a very really infinitesimal optical spot over here, as we will learn in wave optics, what you will get is not a sort of straight line of light, but you will get a very strong diffraction, right? So what will happen if you illuminate a single spot here is the light will spread violently into the green, and then what will happen is a kind of a complicated issue, right? So the way I'm essentially, by claiming diffraction, I got around the problem that you're posing, because as long as I have a finite pencil of rays coming here, then the same thing will happen, right? Because I can always compare two rays that enter at a slightly different indices, then the same argument follows. So this pencil will also kind of focus in the same. So basically, I can remove parts of that ray diagram, and the same thing will still happen according to geometrical optics. Diffraction says different, right? But according to geometrical optics, I can remove portions of these rays and still have focusing. There's another objection that I haven't heard yet. I'm not finished. I am not satisfied that I answered Kalpesh's question yet. And I see that Kalpesh is also skeptical, and I hope someone... I have another slide to bring up the objection, but I'm wondering if someone will bring it up. Or maybe another objection. At least that's... There's one objection that I thought of, but there may be others.
Question.
That's a bit too early for... Yeah.
Why is it that the ray on top bends to slow down to meet the ray that's traveling through the denser medium versus both of them traveling to the less dense optical medium? Because that could also
That's the objection. That's exactly the objection. So the objection is, who says that the central ray should go straight, right? I sort of silently took it for granted that the central ray here goes straight, and therefore this other ray has to race in order to meet it, right? Why don't the two rays go like this? Is this your question? I mean, yeah. Why don't the two rays, why do they both do like this? They seem to be doing the correct thing. They seem to be both going toward the lower index. Okay. We know, again, we can argue that this should happen, but we know from physics that this does not happen. So what is the physical...
That can't possibly happen
by
symmetry.
Ah, okay. Thank you. Actually, it is not a question of symmetry. Because, indeed, in this case, I assume that the refractive index is symmetric, right? However, now let me see if I can do this without revealing my next slide. Okay. However, I can make an asymmetric index profile. Okay, so this is a simulation of the green with a symmetric quadratic index. Here, I made the profile asymmetric. So basically, this is the equation here. I should simply draw it. Ah, except I don't have a marker. Anyway, basically here, the index of refraction is a parabola that has a different slope above and different slope below. So you see that even though this is asymmetric, stubbornly, the central ray still goes straight. So therefore, it is not symmetry, which makes the previous case impossible.
But, well, I said symmetry, but if you go to your next one, that ray that's going straight along the center, where's it gone? Yeah. That ray goes straight, doesn't it?
Yep.
And that's because there's no transverse gradient in electric in the refractive index where it's propagating,
okay.
I guess.
Okay, yes. That is true. There's no moment to push it, right? Yeah, and that I agree with. However, that really still does not answer his question, because the reason momentum works, the reason we apply Snell's law, for example, is because we claim path minimization, right? So I suppose you could argue this way. I have another argument, actually, why this ray must go straight. Actually, I don't know if it must go straight, but I have another argument why basically this is impossible, why this is physically incorrect.
If you do that, isn't it true that the bottom ray's path is still longer than the top ray's path because of the index of refraction is low, and then it's just low all the way, and yeah.
Exactly. If you do that, there is no way ever that this ray will catch up, right? Because this ray now, not only is it going through a higher index of refraction, it is also following a longer geometrical trajectory. So therefore, if these two rays ever meet again, okay, they might meet at a finite distance. The way I drew them here, at some point they will meet again, right? Or they might meet at infinity. They might somehow become parallel and meet again at infinity. But no matter what, this ray over here has traveled the longer optical path. And that is a clear violation of Fermat. So we basically arrived at an impossibility. So this is physically then incorrect. That is the reason why the bays have to, the bays don't have to rend. The rays have to bend inwards. And so the proper then interpretation of Fermat's principle, and actually the book has an interesting discussion about this. We can claim, yes, that Fermat minimizes the optical path, but perhaps, or at least linguistically more precise definition, is that Fermat requires that the path of the rays is stationary. Now, stationary, in mathematics, what it means that if you perturb it in some way, you will get a bigger answer, if you perturb it in any way. So remember, I wish I had the marker. I think I can just use a pen, though. Okay, let's try with a pen. And you guys tell me in Boston if you can see it. Remember with Fermat, we did this analogy. We said, you can see it, right? I should have said remember with Snell's law. Snell's law says that the ray must do something like this in order to connect this point to this point. So mathematically, what we derived is that any other possibility, this, and also, why not this, eh? These are all different possible ray trajectories. There is a mathematical tool, it's called calculus of variation, which does a miraculous thing. It somehow compares all of these possible trajectories. And then it arrives at the minimum trajectory. And it tells us, no. No matter what, these are infinite possibilities, right? You can imagine. But this tool, calculus of variations, actually tells us eventually that all of these give us a longer total optical path, and the only true one, if you wish, the one that minimizes, the stationary one, is the one that I drew kind of bolder here. Okay? So this is the proper way to interpret Fermat. It is not that the single ray will actually, you know, look for the lower index of refraction. It is actually that when you have a bundle of rays that share a common beginning and a common end, then the trajectory that these rays will follow will be such that they are all equal, and that this trajectory now is stationary, in the sense that if you were to perturb it in any way, if you were to move some of these rays up or down or bend them and whatever, you would end up getting a longer trajectory. Okay? That's the proper interpretation of Fermat. So this is actually a very interesting topic. And I confess that when I was a student, I was also bothered by this, right? I mean, you know, the ray seems to be doing the wrong thing after all. It seems to be going really where it shouldn't go. Why? Well, the reason is, as we just described, because the path has to be stationary. The bottom line out of this, which will actually be useful in our ensuing discussion of Hamiltonian optics, is that the index of refraction is acting a little bit like gravity. Actually, it's acting like gravity more than you would think. The index of refraction seems to be attracting the rays, which is, again, is a little bit counterintuitive if you interpret Fermat as a minimum path, but after we went through this explanation, it makes sense, right? The index of refraction pretty much collects rays near it. Yes, there's a question.
Jujar, I think if we consider the interfaces left to right, the geometry works out. And so if we assume any ray coming at, say, like this, going from left bottom to top right, then it is going from higher index to lower index, which means it will tend to increase its angle with respect to normal. So it will keep bending like this. And at some point, there will be total internal reflection, and it will bend towards the...
Yeah, that will happen here, for example, right?
Yeah.
This ray continues,
and then again,
it will bend. Yeah.
Yeah. So maybe, I mean, that's just another way of looking at the problem, that if you consider the interface to be normal to the change in the refractive index, then, yeah.
Yeah, actually, that's true. Snell's law also justifies this attraction, right? I mean, the point that is really hard to swallow is why this ray starts bending inwards at this interface. After it has started, then it has to fall, right? Because Snell says that it should fall. So, yeah, so that is consistent. So really, this acts, you can think of a mechanical analogy, which would be like, imagine that you take a tube and you cut it in half, right? So now you have this hollow sphere, and then you launch a billiard ball into that surface. What will the billiard ball do? Well, it will spin, right? It will go down and then up again and then down again and spin and spin and spin. Right? So basically, the surface of this, in this sort of mechanical analogy, the equivalent of the surface shape is the index of refraction here. And of course, the billiard ball is subject to its own gravity, and the surface, how do you call it, the Hertz contact from the surface, and so on and so forth. But the bottom line is that this is a mechanical analogy for this is gravity, attraction. Okay? Yes, provided you define the gravitational potential appropriately in terms of the index of refraction. And this will actually come up near the end of the Hamiltonian lecture. So I will show you exactly the formula. Did everybody hear his question?
No.
Okay, could you repeat?
Yeah, I was asking, is the analogy between the gravitational force and the refractive index complete?
Yeah, and you heard my answer. Okay. Okay, now that I have a marker, let me also answer. So in this case, what I did is on the left-hand side, we have the familiar a quadratic index profile. So this is n0 minus some coefficient times x squared. On the right-hand side, what I did is I chose an index that is somehow like this. Okay, I'm exaggerating, but so basically it is still a parabola on the left and the right, but it has a different curvature on the left and the right. And the point here is that the central ray still goes straight. Of course, this is a terrible lens, right? It does something really horrible back here. It does not focus properly and so on and so forth. But the only reason I did this is to show that that the ray here goes straight, not because the index of refraction is symmetrical. Even though Collins' point is well taken, I mean, the reason it goes straight here, again, you can think of it in terms of Snell's law. It does not want to go this way because it would, you know, it would bend to a longer optical path than the ray next to it. It does not go want to go down because, again, it would end up with a longer optical path with respect to the ray below it. So therefore, it has to go straight, right? Can you imagine a situation? Is it always straight? Like, can I actually bend this ray? What would I have to do to make this central ray bend? Actually, Colin answered it already. Yeah, they cannot see you. Can you, yeah.
Curve the whole profile. Yeah.
So you have to put a gradient along z on the index of refraction. Then if the ray sees a tilted interface, which basically means a gradient of the index of refraction here, it will bend, right? Because again, Snell tells it to bend. So, but since there's no, since here the index has no z dependency, then the ray must go straight. OK. Okay, so first of all, thanks thanks to Kalpesh for asking this question, because it turned out to be a really, really helpful one. And so in addition to that, today we have kind of two more things to do. So one is we finish the Hamiltonian optics discussion, and then we'll start talking about wave optics. So we'll see how far we go. I have to make some announcements near the end. So I will try to save about 5 minutes near the end for my announcements. OK. So last time, we were discussing gradient index optics. And just to briefly remind you, we kind of went, this is actually what prompted Kalpesh's question. We went through this derivation where we had the gradient index element. I will stop saying gradient index. It gives me actually, it's difficult for me to pronounce, a green, right? So we had the green element. And we did this simple derivation, which basically said that this green element is acting like a lens. And again, with our newfound wisdom, it is acting like a lens by virtue of the attraction of the rays by the region of high index near the center of this element. And we also went through this other case of axial green. And we also said that that's interesting. If you only have z gradient, then it is still not a lens. You know, I'll let you think about it by yourself. In order to make it a lens, you have to have an x gradient in the index of refraction. So this case is somewhere in between, where you have a z gradient, so the index is higher in the front and lower in the back. But in order to get optical power, that is to get focusing power, in this case, you actually grind. In addition, you grind it to a sphere. And we said that the reason you do this axial green here is because you want to correct for spherical aberration, okay? So if you compare the paths now of this ray to this ray, okay, in this case, this ray goes through a longer optical path because the index is uniformly high here, therefore it bends faster. In this case, by lowering the index of refraction that this ray goes, you actually force it to go to a longer geometrical trajectory, therefore you are pushing it further to the back. Okay? This is another way to interpret the way this element corrects. You can interpret it with Snell's law. This is what we did last time. But now, with our newfound wisdom on optical paths and Fermat, we can also explain it this way. I lowered the optical path by virtue of lowering the index here. Therefore, the ray has to go outwards in order to increase its travel distance. Okay? And still maintain the same path as the central ray. Okay, so the net effect is that you're correcting the bad quality focus here that was caused by the spherical aberration. And I believe where we left it last time is we asked this question, well, what if I have an arbitrary index of refraction as a function of position? What if, this is not quadratic, this is not axial, this is some general function of R, the Cartesian coordinate. What then? I lost my train of thought. Yeah, what is the path of the, that is the, what is the trajectory of the rays that go through this variable index medium? And I don't remember how far I went here, but we basically took a turn here. And we started talking about mechanics to some of your surprise. So I don't know, can you remind me, how far did I go? Did I actually finish this example or no?
Yeah, I think so, right? Yeah, we covered this.
Yeah. Okay, so I don't feel like going it again anyway, because this is sort of good old physics 101 kind of thing. What might be a little bit unfamiliar is this development here, which some of you may have seen, some of you may not have seen. So this is really not doing anything spectacular. This is a simple mathematical manipulation. So we start with the equation of motion for the mechanical oscillator. So the equation of motion for the mechanical, not the question of motion, but the energy for the mechanical oscillator. So the energy consists, of course, of two terms. One of them is the, if you wish, the elastic energy, the potential that is due to the restoring force of the spring. And the other is the kinetic energy. Okay. And V is the velocity. So V is basically x dot, okay, the first time derivative of the position. Okay, so this is one thing that we know. This is the energy of the system, and since in our model there's no dissipation, the energy must be conserved. I can also write an equation of motion for this system, and since it is a simple spring force kind of system, I expect my equation of motion to be, what, to be second order, so it will be something of this sort. Mx double dot plus kx equal the force, right? The excitation. Okay, so let's say that the system is free. There's no force. So if it is moving, it is moving because of a prior excitation, right? Which, if I start it, it will go on forever because there's no dissipation, there's no place for the energy to go. If you get this thing moving, it will go on forever. But now, there's no force. So basically, I can write down the equation of motion like this, as a homogeneous equation. Okay, so there is a trick that those of you who use MATLAB to solve differential equations are very familiar, and the trick is the following. You break this higher order differential equation, you break it down into as many as you need first order differential equations. Since this is a second order equation, you only need two first order equations, and the way you do it is basically you write an equation that looks kind of stupid. The equation says that x dot equals V. This is one equation. And then the other equation comes from this one. Since x dot equals v, it means that x double dot equals v dot. This is the acceleration. So the second equation now comes from this. That is v dot equals minus whatever, k over m times x. Okay. Now, I can define a vector. X, v. And what this set of equation here has done, it has actually connected the first derivative of this vector with the vector itself via a matrix. And here is the vector in its first derivative. Here is the vector itself. And what I have to put here in order to make this look correct is I have to put 1 here and then minus k over m here and then zeros and then I'm done. So this is, again, if you ever used MATLAB to solve an ordinary differential equation, you're familiar with this. This is MATLAB actually forces you to rewrite your equation this way. But it turns out that this kind of method actually preceded MATLAB by about a century, because this is a standard way of writing the equation in, actually, I believe it was Poincaré who first came up with this. It's a standard way to derive the dynamics of a dynamic of a system. And this is not, of course, I don't want to spend too much time on this, but what this slide basically points out to you is the following. That if you take this expression here, which we call the energy, but now we'll call it, it is, of course you cannot see it because it's hidden. Okay, now you can see it. So this expression is normally called the energy, but today I will call it the Hamiltonian, and it will become apparent in a second why. But if you take this expression, this is now a function of the two dynamical variables. The same two variables that appeared in this expression over here, they actually get into this equation, x, v, right? It's a bit of a funny way to think about it, but sure, right? It, certainly, you see x here and you see v here. And actually, I don't like v very much, because if I keep using v, I will not come up with a correct set of equations. I will replace v with the momentum. So that's a minor cheating. Instead of v, I will replace it with p. So p, the momentum, is simply m times v, right? So I haven't cheated in any major way. I just, you know, I just did a simple multiplication. So if you replace p here, then the equation will look like this. Nothing changes here. This part will look like 1 half p squared over m. Okay. Oh, sorry. Okay. Okay, so nothing major here. The magic now, it's not really magic. There's a good reason for it. But, you know, it looks like magic is that if I do the following, if I take the two derivatives of this expression with respect to x and p. So if I take dh dx, and if I take dh dp, can you still see? Yeah. Okay, what I get? If I get dh dx, what is that? It is kx, right? And if I take dh dp, I will get p over m. Okay. So if I look carefully here, this is p over m, right? That's the velocity. And this is minus kp, isn't it? What am I doing? I'm sorry. I have, of course, I know why. I have v dot here. Instead of v dot, let me rewrite it in terms of p dot. If I do in terms of p dot, I multiply by m both sides of the equation, I will get minus kx. Okay. I don't have to do anything else now. All right. So what do I get? Well, I get that dh dp, which equals p over m, is this term in this equation. And if I get dh dx, which is kx, is actually this term in this equation. So basically, by taking the partial derivatives of this expression, the Hamiltonian, with respect to my two dynamical variables, position and momentum, I came up with the equation of motion decomposed in the dynamical variables MATLAB style, or actually Poincaré is probably shifting in his grave, Poincaré style, okay? In the way we write dynamical systems. Okay. So this is really what I say in the top of the slide. Of course, I say it in a slightly more formal way. And then the rest of what I do is I simply solve this equation, but I will not do it here. This is a simple harmonic oscillator, right? The mechanical system I showed before is a cart that will move forever, eternally, in a sinusoidal fashion. It's kind of interesting, I guess, that the energy alternates between 100% kinetic, which happens when the cart, the particle, moves through the rest position, because then it is the maximum velocity and has no potential. It is the rest position of the spring. And it converts to completely elastic when it goes to the edge of the range of motion, right? Because over there, it has to reverse. Therefore, it will go to velocity zero momentarily. And the kinetic energy has vanished. At this point, it has become all potential. Okay, this is probably boring because this stuff is very well known. What I really want to do is I want to establish a connection between this very nice, very well-known mechanical stuff with optics. So basically what I will do now is I will derive, I will not really derive, but I will show you a set of Hamiltonian equations that actually describe ray trajectories. And what is really spectacular is that, as you pointed out earlier, they will turn out to have an exact mechanical analogy if you use a certain equation for the index of refraction. So we'll get to that. So in order to, so there's two ways to derive the Hamiltonian equations. Does anybody know, in the field of mechanics, does anybody know how we get the Hamiltonian equations? What is the sort of the process? Well, I sort of just described it over here, but I guess what I'm trying to get to is, how did this come about? Of course, it came about from my physical intuition, right? Because I know that I have kinetic, you know. Someone told me, I don't know, 1,000 years ago when I was a student in school, that this is the case, right? But
it's the invariant property of the system. It's the total energy we put in at the start.
Okay, yes. So it is the invariance of the system. And also, mechanical systems, they also have a Fermat principle of their own. If you recall, mechanical systems also try to minimize their potential as they go, the trajectory that they follow tries to minimize their potential. Okay, so a good example of that is actually, forget that this is optics, imagine that what you see here in this sort of fancy looking diagram, this is not an index of refraction, but this is a star. Imagine that the center of this have a massive object, a massive gravitational attraction, right? Like the, actually, yeah, the sun, right? And imagine that the ray, that the, it's not a ray anymore, but imagine that the red trajectory is the path of a satellite, right? This is convincing, isn't it? If you allow the grayscale to denote gravity now, not index of refraction, but potential due to the gravitational field exerted by the planet, then if I launch a spacecraft or a satellite or whatever in the vicinity of this gravitational field, as you know, you may be, if you are a sort of amateur astronomer or amateur, aspiring astronaut, if you are, then you know that depending on how you launch your spacecraft, sometimes it will actually sort of circle once and then escape. That's very bad, right? Because it means that if you are an astronaut, you are gone to space forever. But also you know that if you launch it properly, then you can actually get it to orbit, right? And orbit means that the dynamics here is such that you will actually start circling this object. Okay. In fact, we never launch spacecraft to stars. Typically, we launch them to planets nearby, but then, all right. Okay, so it turns out that the trajectories that these spacecraft follow, actually, they also minimize their quote-unquote optical path, where, you know, there's no index of refraction then, it is just gravity. But they actually do follow the minimum path around the star, and in fact, this has been known for more than a century. I mean, Copernicus even hinted at that in his work, right, when he computed the orbits of the stars, of the planets in the solar system, okay? So this is very well-known stuff. Okay, so what I will do now then is I will actually drive you, without really proving anything, but I will drive you to a set of Hamiltonian equations that describe the same analogy but for optics now. So in order to derive our Hamiltonian equations, we actually need two postulates. Now what does it mean, postulate? Do you know that word? Yeah, button, yeah.
I have a doubt regarding definition of Hamiltonian. Why can't it be some other invariant quantity like angular momentum or linear momentum and energy in this case?
Okay, so you're actually there. You're forcing me to say what I didn't say before. Okay, how did this come about? This comes about, and I have to apologize now because I will throw a lot of jargon at you. This comes about from something called the Lagrangian principle. So the Lagrangian is very, actually, if you write the Lagrangian, it looks very similar to this one. It looks very similar to this. The Lagrangian, the question you ask in the mechanical system is what is the trajectory that the system will follow, right? So you have a particle or a set of particles and you ask what is the trajectory. The Lagrangian actually looks very similar to this, but with a minus sign. And I never quite remember if you put the minus sign here or here, but anyway, one of those has a minus sign. Okay. And so what you do then is you put this Lagrangian into this integral, and you say that the trajectory that the particle will follow actually minimizes this integral. Now this has a very good physical justification because this is actually Newton's law. The way you get this Lagrangian is you start with good old Newton, who says that then you multiply okay, I haven't cheated, I multiplied it with a quantity that is hopefully non-zero, and then you can write it down as 1m actually not quite zero anymore, but constant. Okay. Now confused my mind with sign somehow. Well, anyway. Not simply plus because this is a restoring force, right? So it should, yeah. But anyway, happily actually derives the Hamiltonian. So I don't know how it happened, but this, if you think about it, this is now the Hamiltonian, isn't it? So by a simple trick on Newton's law, it derived. That's not quite what I was expecting, but it happened anyway. Okay, so I answered your question simpler than I was expecting it to be. Okay, so there is the Hamiltonian, right? Now, why that and why not the momentum? That really has to do with the Lagrangian, but let's not go there. Okay. It's clear what I did here, right? This is just a simple manipulation that I learned from Professor Jerry Whittam at Caltech, actually. Okay. Oops, I think I skipped the slide. Here we go. Okay. So we were at this word, postulate. What is a postulate? What does postulate mean? Button.
We accept something without, we say something and we accept something.
That's right. So the postulate is a good way to develop a scientific theory in the following sense. First of all, postulates cannot be very complicated, right? So it is something simple that we accept with two caveats. One is that we accept it because it is justified by observation. So a postulate had better be something that has never been violated to our knowledge. For example, the sun rises every day. As far as humanity has recorded history, this has happened every day, except, of course, in the north above the Arctic, right, where some days the sun does not rise. Okay, fine. So that's one. And the second is that the theory that follows from the postulate has to be self-consistent, right? So it has to be mathematically consistent. So typically, the postulates are things that I don't quite feel like proving, but they're good assumptions, like assumptions that cannot be very easily challenged. Okay. So the assumptions here, one of them is that rays are continuous. Okay. That really cannot be very easily challenged because, I mean, if a ray were to jump, that would be really strange, right? And I can quote a number of physical reasons why this would be really strange. For one is that relativity, you know. It means that somehow a photon, if we believe that photons follow the ray trajectories, it means that somehow light, within zero time, actually traversed a finite distance. That is impossible. So that is one good reason, okay? So if you accept then that the rays must be continuous, and actually it is only continuity. I'm not saying that the rays are differentiable. So the rays can bend like this. So here, actually, obviously, it is non-differentiable, but it's still continuous, right? So the postulate actually talks about continuity, not differentiability. Piecewise differentiable, yes, it is, because it is certainly piecewise differentiable here, piecewise differentiable there. This is actually a technicality. Functions that are not piecewise differentiable are really nasty beasts, like Weierstrass functions and stuff like that, which normally we don't deal with in engineering. So basically, the second condition here is a mathematical technicality. So we don't have to dwell on that. Okay, if now here's something that probably as engineers we got turned off by when we learned it in calculus, but it's actually a useful thing. It is called the mean value theorem. And the mean value theorem says the following. It says that if you are given a continuous piecewise differentiable function, so here it is. Okay, so this is x, this is f of x, so this curve here is f of x. This is some function. I have x1, x2, f of x1, f of x2. Okay, the mean value theorem says that according to the conditions I just stated, there is a point somewhere in this interval satisfying the following property, that f of x2 minus x1 over x2 minus x1 equals f prime of x. So basically, this ratio, I can pick a point xi somewhere in this interval such that the value of the derivative of a function at this point equals this ratio. And of course, you can realize immediately that if you make the interval very, very tiny, then of course you get the definition of the derivative itself. But the mean value theorem is a little bit more general. And it is the mean value theorem that I use here in order to write this equation. This is basically the mean value theorem, where the quantity of interest that I applied is the ray trajectory. Let me back up for a second. I should have started with something else. What am I really plotting here? So the red curve is the ray trajectory. So I describe the ray trajectory as a vector q. So the vector is a position vector, right? This is a position. This is the origin of the coordinates, and q is the position vector. And then I parameterize it with a variable s. So basically, s is an index. As I increase, as I step through s, I basically walk along this trajectory, right? Okay, so you can think of s as time, right? As time goes forward, the light particles, if you wish, are moving along this curve. Okay. And at each point on the curve, since it is continuous and piecewise differentiable, at each point I can define a tangent, except, of course, the points where it is not differentiable, but let's skip those for a moment. In the point that is differentiable, I can define a tangent. And this tangent is the vector p. Okay, so this vector p is actually the momentum of the ray. Okay, very good. So since the tangent is associated with the derivative, in fact, in high-dimensional space, it is even more obvious because the tangent really points towards it is the tangent, right? Then this really is an expression of the mean value theorem for the continuous and piecewise differentiable ray. And of course, I can write it down as a differential equation by taking the limit. And there is one element that is sort of missing here. That's the normalization. Why did I pick to normalize by the value of the tangent? Well, let's leave that alone for now. Let's assume that it is correct and see if it will lead us to an acceptable physical result, right? But so what I'm trying to say is that the denominator here is arbitrary. I don't really need it. I can throw it out. It is a normalization parameter, and I put it there because with hindsight, it will lead me to a physically acceptable result. Okay. The second postulate is a little bit easier to swallow thanks to Kalpesh's question, because the second postulate says that the ray, very similar to a spacecraft approaching a planet, a ray actually is attracted by a high index of refraction. And the way we quantify this assumption is we say that if the ray enters a region where the index of refraction is variable, that is, it has a gradient, so that's the gradient, in case you have forgotten, I hope not. So if there's a gradient in the index of refraction, the ray will receive a kick. And the kick of the ray, what a kick really means is that its momentum will change, right? Therefore, the trajectory will bend, and the kick, that is the change in momentum, will be proportional to the gradient. That is the postulate. And I will not do it here, but it is a little bit of a long derivation. I have to warn you, I went through it and then I decided not to put it in the notes because it is a little bit involved. But this actually turns out to be equivalent to Snell's law, okay? So if you want, I can give you a copy of my notes where I derived it, but if you don't feel like going through 2 pages of calculus of variations, then please take my word for it. This is actually Snell's law, but written in a funny way. Okay. So that's then the sort of the variational version, and we can write it down as a differential equation, and we get this. Okay. So now we're kind of going backwards. Now we have 2 differential equations. Yes.
Why the position variables are different on the both sides, S and S dash?
Oh, you mean the S prime?
Yeah, S prime.
Sorry. Oh, the S prime is actually the xi from the mean value theorem.
When you write it in the variational form,
S prime can be anywhere in here, right?
Right.
I don't know exactly where it is.
Yeah,
and very similar to here. Actually, again, here I invoke the mean value theorem.
I didn't say it.
Right? Yeah. But of course, when you do the differential form, it vanishes, right? Because the interval collapses.
Yeah.
Okay. So now what I have is actually 2 differential equations. One of them contains a trajectory. The other contains a momentum. So this is basically the two-dimensional analog to the dynamical system that I wrote here, right? I have an equation for the position, this is it, and I have a differential equation for the momentum, this is it. This is the equation for the position, and this is the equation for the momentum. I use Q for the position here because that's the convention in geometrical optics. People use Q, not X, but it is Q is the position vector. Okay. So that's fine. The question is there anything that is conserved here? Did I derive any sort of Hamiltonian? Well, it turns out, and again, this requires a bit of hindsight, but I can pick the Hamiltonian to be of this form, to be equal to the magnitude of the momentum minus the index of refraction. Okay, let's write down the two equations again. Okay, so this is the equations. And the Hamiltonian that I picked is H equals P minus N of Q. Okay, you can see now that if I do the gradient, now in the high dimensional case, instead of the derivatives of the Hamiltonian, I have to take the gradients, right? So if I do the gradient of the Hamiltonian with respect to, let's do the first one, with respect to N, I'm sorry, with respect to Q, this is really what I'm going to get, right? Okay, and if I do the Hamiltonian with respect to P, okay, what is P? P right? So for example, if you do dH dPx, you will get Px over the square root. Okay? And then you can follow dH dPy and so on. So therefore the gradient, which is defined as a vector okay, so you can basically see from this simple derivation here that by this choice of Hamiltonian, the Hamiltonian that I wrote here, I can actually derive consistently the set of Hamiltonian equations. So I basically find that dQ dS equals the derivative or the gradient of the Hamiltonian with respect to the conjugate variable, the momentum, and the other way around, for dp, ds. So this equation then is the Hamiltonian. It is not the only one, by the way. Hamiltonians, they're not unique. Clearly, for example, I can add an arbitrary constant here, I can get another Hamiltonian. So and we know that from energy also. Energy is not unique. I can add constants to it and it is still remains energy. So you need a reference basically to decide which way to go. But anyway, this is one possible Hamiltonian. Okay, how do we explain it physically? Well, the momentum is a vector, right? And what the Hamiltonian says that the difference between the magnitude of the vector and at a given position, the index of refraction, the difference has to be constant. I can pick this constant to be zero. Since it is arbitrary, let me pick it to be zero. If that is the case, what I'm really saying is that the momentum wave, the vector of the momentum is constrained to lie on a sphere. And that actually is known as the Descartes sphere, but it was not really, Descartes was not the first one to make this observation. It was an Arab scientist whose name is, I believe, Alhazen, who actually made this observation for the first time. And actually, Elhazen also derived Snell's law for the first time. So basically, what the Hamiltonian that we derived says is that the momentum of the ray is constrained to lie on a sphere. Okay. Now this is, I did not go through the slide when we did Snell's law, but it is in your notes. And you may have noticed it if you were diligent when you were studying the notes, because I actually showed this slide as another way to derive Descartes' law. So what is happening here is I have the familiar situation of Snell's law. I have an index of, I'm sorry, I have a medium of index n to the left, and the medium of index n prime to the right. And in each medium, I associate a sphere with a radius equal to what Descartes predicts. So the sphere has radius n on the left, and another sphere with radius n prime on the right. In this case, n prime is bigger than n, so the sphere is bigger on the right-hand side. So Snell's law here is derived by applied momentum conservation, which actually Professor Shepard mentioned in the beginning when we were discussing Elpes's question. And momentum conservation says the following, in the vertical direction, up and down, clearly this geometry is invariant. There's no change. So therefore, the momentum must be conserved. The momentum on the left-hand side, which I denote as P vertical, and the momentum on the right-hand side, P prime vertical, must be equal. And since the momenta come from Descartes' calculation equal to this, then basically these vertical components are obtained by projecting the radius of the sphere onto the vertical axis. And of course, if you do this now, you immediately get Snell's law, because this angle is theta, so therefore this length equals n sine theta on the left-hand side and n prime sine theta prime on the right-hand side. So that is yet another way to obtain Snell's law. And of course, you might wonder what happens to the momentum on the longitudinal dimension. Well, that's okay. You can have a change in momentum there because there is there's a change in media, right? So the change in media actually corresponds to a change of momentum, and momentum is conserved. So it actually means that the medium here, if you actually use proper electrodynamics, there is actually a force applied in this medium here due to the change in momentum of the light. But this is beyond the scope of the class, so we'll not discuss it in any greater detail. So this kind of picture here with a Descartes sphere, it also applies to a green medium. So here is a medium whose index of refraction is variable, so you go from low to high. Again, the convention is gray means higher index. And you can break it down, like we did again at the beginning of the class, we can break it down into slices of progressively higher index, and you can apply Snell's law using either Snell itself or the succession of Descartes spheres. You can apply it as the ray goes down, and then either because it has to match the momentum or because it has to satisfy Snell's law, the two statements are exactly equivalent, the ray must bend its path. So this is yet another way to justify why the ray is bending. Well, it is bending because it must conserve the value of this Hamiltonian. It must lie on the Descartes sphere. But of course, in the green medium, we have to be a little bit careful because the sphere has a variable radius, as you can see in this diagram over here. Okay. Now let's come to the other question that was asked. Is there an analogy between mechanics and optics? And because we're running a little bit late, I don't want to spend too long on this analogy. It's a very interesting one. I'll let you study it. And if you like, we can also discuss later. But basically, the analogy comes from this. We go back and rewrite the Hamiltonian equation of the mechanical system as a sort of unassailable kinetic energy term. The first term over here is clearly the kinetic energy, the term that looks like momentum square over 2m. Then the potential, we wrote the potential before. In the case of the elastic spring, the elastic potential was V of 2 equals 1/2 k 2f. Okay, that's one special case of a restoring force of an elastic potential, but it can be more general, right? So we write it as V of 2. And then the rest of the definitions are basically straightforward. The momentum equals m times the time derivative of the trajectory. Anyway, like I said, I don't want to go through this in great detail, but basically, if as a restoring force, we use the index of refraction squared divided by 2m, where m is like a fictitious mass that we have to assign to the photon, then we basically get a one-to-one analogy. This is very interesting because it is really acting like a spring or like gravity, but for gravity is not exactly the same because gravity is like 1 over r, so you have to make an approximation and blah, blah, blah. But if you think of it as a spring, then you get basically a one-to-one analogy. So this is kind of interesting. Okay. And the last thing that I want to say, because this is sort of, it has a practical significance, is that once we write down the Hamiltonian, once we write down the Hamiltonian equations, then it is very convenient, in addition to all this nice physics and intuition and so on, it is very convenient because we can just plug them in MATLAB and solve them. Eh? So if someone is giving us a gradient index medium, now whether it is quadratic or cubic or quantum, whatever, 27th polynomial or anything for that matter, we can just solve it using this set of equations. And here what I did is I did an example of a quadratic index medium on axis, off axis. You can see that on axis is actually pretty good. It is not completely free of spherical, but pretty close to free. You can see it does come to a very nice geometrical focus. Of course, off axis, it has a terrible aberration that we called what? How do we call this particular aberration that you see here?
Comma.
Comma. Yeah. Okay. Yes.
Aronov. Yeah. Can you use the index of refraction to correct for comma?
Yes. Yes. Of course. In fact, this is, believe it or not, this is a research project in my group, which says that suppose you wanted to define an arbitrary index distribution here in order to correct for a given set of aberrations. So someone is giving you specifications. They say, I want to eliminate comma for this angle of incidence. I want to eliminate other aberrations, for example, astigmatism and so on. Then, in principle, you can come up with some index of refraction n of r, which, if properly chosen, will eliminate these specified aberrations. Now, of course, that's pretty easy, actually. That doesn't need research. It's kind of like a computational problem. But how do you implement an arbitrary index of refraction? That's difficult. So we're actually working on that in my group. But yeah, in principle, you can. In practice, with commercial greens, it is a little bit difficult, actually. You would probably have to use something more than a green, as far as I know. Yeah. Yeah.
On the previous slide, you said that n has to be greater than 1.
Can you press the button, please?
Yeah.
Can you press the button?
He is pressing it. Maybe it's broken. Okay, maybe you can.
On the previous slide, you said something about physical. N has to be greater than zero.
You got me. Okay. Yes. Uh, Yeah, I said that n has to be bigger than 1. Greater than 1. Yeah, the question is, can n be less than 1 and less than 0? Okay. From the point of view of geometrical optics, n is the speed of light in a bulk medium. And in ordinary bulk media that we use in geometrical optics, light is always slower than vacuum, so n is always bigger than 1. In a few lectures, when we do proper electromagnetics, also let me say that so far n has been a phenomenological quantity. This is another funny word like postulate. What does it mean, phenomenological? Okay, it means a quantity that I have not justified its physical origin. I just pulled it out of a hat and I said, hey, you know what? The index of refraction in a medium, I'm sorry, the speed of light in a medium is less than the speed in a vacuum, right? So therefore, n is bigger than 1. Now, when we do the proper physical origins of n, we will see that indeed n can be less than 1. It can even be negative. And that's another hot topic in research optics nowadays. So it is not necessary. That's true. But if you take it into the mechanical analogy, interestingly enough, if you allow n to go into these sort of strange modern sort of regions where it is less than 1 and even negative, then in the mechanical analogy you would end up with negative energy, which is kind of interesting. It doesn't mean anything. This is just an analogy, right? You know, it doesn't invalidate anything, but it is kind of interesting. And let me say up front, n becoming smaller than 1 does not mean that I violate relativity. It does not mean that that something moves faster than the speed of light. N, as we will see just today, actually, n is what we call the phase velocity. And the phase velocity of a wave can be much greater than the speed of light because the phase carries no information. That's sort of the classical way to justify it. So I can allow actually n to be less than 1, and I'm perfectly fine. So it is not necessary, but so I should have put a qualification here. I don't know, not physically allowable, but how you say it? Everyday intuition allowable, perhaps. But of course, physicists can do much better than everyday intuition. Okay, so let's resume for another 20 minutes or so, and we'll continue on Monday. So what I would like to do today is start the description of wave optics. So basically, the reason we followed geometrical optics, and it was good enough to explain a number of interesting things for us, imaging systems, gradient indices and so on. But geometrical optics also has some serious failures. The most important of those is that when light interacts with very small features, geometrical optics fails. So for example, I used it when I answered Kalpesh's question. If you limit light to a single ray, that is to an infinitesimally small spot, then geometrical optics patently fails. So the pictures that it gives are completely wrong. So in order to deal with that, we have to deal with light as a wave phenomenon. And there's some interesting history there. Newton was a big proponent of geometrical or particle description of light. Some other contemporaries of his, like Huygens, Fresnel, and sort of the continental school, they were proponents of the of the wave theory. And for many years, the question remained unsettled until Maxwell, in the end, I think 1899 or 1896 or something like that, James Clerk Maxwell, actually a professor of fluid mechanics, came up with a set of equations that proved very convincingly that light is a wave. And then 10 years later, quantum mechanics proved that light is also a particle. So both were correct, both Newton and the continental school were correct. So anyway, so you can think now that we're basically now moving from England to the continental Europe, right? Because we're abandoning the geometrical optics theory and we're moving to wave optics. Now, waves, of course, are a very pervasive phenomenon that we see around us, and they manifest themselves in many different forms. So we're all familiar with waves in seawater or rivers and so on. We're familiar with sound waves. This is actually Singapore's founder, Lee Kuan Yew, giving a speech. So we can communicate by sound waves. That's another form of a material wave. So like water wave, sound waves are material waves. You set the air particles in motion when you speak. We're also familiar with electromagnetic or radio waves, not because we can see them. These are actually not something that you can touch, but all of us who use cell phones, old-fashioned radios, and so on, we use them. This is actually an old-fashioned antenna. It's not that old-fashioned. If you go to places like Europe, like Greece, for example, many homes still have those antennas in their roof. So this is the way people used to receive television signals before cable TV. And finally, there's other waves that are sort of not quite obvious that they're waves. This is a very interesting geological phenomenon in the Philippines. It's called the Chocolate Hills. There's a number, it's actually hundreds of very small hills, not very tall. You might say, well, what kind of a wave is that? The hills are not moving. Well, actually, they're not moving in our time scale, but in geological terms, they actually move. And sometimes this motion, as you know, the motion of the Earth, it can actually happen in time scales that are perceived by humans, and then it's called an earthquake. It's a very nasty phenomenon. Eh? So waves, the point is that here that waves manifest themselves in many different forms. Of course, I omitted another important manifestation, which is quantum mechanics. Quantum mechanics says that everything is actually wave, including yourselves and me, and every particle is also described as a wave. So electrons can be thought of as waves, and so on and so forth. Anyway, so the waves are in fact so pervasive that there's no proper definition. And to paraphrase something that an artist said once about art, he said that art cannot be defined, but you know it when you see it. Okay, that's actually a very good way to put it, at least as far as art is concerned. But it's also true about waves. There's no single, because there's a great variation in the way waves occur, there's no really way, there's no proper definition. What I attempted here is the simplest possible all-inclusive definition as a traveling disturbance. As far as I can tell, it is certainly inclusive of all waves. Of course, it includes other things that may not be waves, like a car moving down the road is also a traveling disturbance. It is clearly not a wave. But anyway, another way to perhaps describe waves is if you there's some evidences of wave behavior, and a very prominent one is what we call interference. So what you see here is, we will see, these are called spherical waves, and we see two point sources emitting these spherical waves. And as they propagate out, you see this very characteristic alternation between bright and dark spots. I have not really said what this thing is. Is it a sound wave, a water wave, an electromagnetic wave? In fact, it could be all of the above. In all of these cases, if I represent as bright the high value of the disturbance and as black the low value of the disturbance, then this sort of not quite periodic, but periodic-like looking behavior is called interference. And when you observe this sort of interference, then it is a pretty good indication that you are actually observing a wave phenomenon. In fact, the reason Fresnel and the Continental School insisted that light is a wave is because they actually observed light interference in experiments. They observed light doing something like that in experiments. So they said, well, wave, it must be a wave then. So another phenomenon which is, actually it is related to interference. When we cover it, it has a different name, it's called diffraction. But then when we cover it, we will see that really it is not a new phenomenon, it is interference in disguise. And diffraction basically says that shadows, the geometrical definition of shadows is incorrect. So if you, what you see here is a wave that is impinging on a block. So it is blocked above and below, and a small portion of it is allowed to pass through. Geometrical optics would have you believe that you would basically get a continuation, unperturbed continuation of the wave in the geometrical shadow of this slit. You can think of it as a slit that the wave goes through. But diffraction says that's not the case. As you can see, there's a rather more complicated pattern that emerges here. And that is another evidence of a wave phenomenon that we will describe quantitatively in great detail later. Okay, so let's take a look a little bit of in some more waves. So for example, the first one, well, it meets my definition, is a traveling disturbance, but it's not a very interesting one because it is just a shape moving. The one that is on the right is perhaps more interesting because now you see sort of, it is more believable that it is a wave, right? It has some oscillation in addition to the traveling disturbance. By the way, oscillatory behavior is also characteristic of waves, right? But it is not necessarily periodic. In fact, you can have a periodic wave, but that's not very interesting. It is the non-periodic waves that are the most interesting ones. Okay. So now, let me go back and play this movie once again. Okay, that's not very interesting. But what you will see here is you will see that it's actually the same envelope that you saw moving on this diagram. You will see it is the same envelope moving over here, but inside you have some wiggles that are also moving. And if you observe it very carefully, you will see that the envelope is moving with a different velocity than the wiggles. The wiggles have a name, by the way. They're called fringes. Can you see? So the wiggles are actually moving faster than the envelope. So this brings us to the definition of what I used to answer Professor Shepard's question about N earlier. I used the term phase velocity. So what you saw in the previous movie, in the one that was on the right-hand side, was an envelope that was moving. So here's the blue one. That's the envelope. And inside, there was a sinusoid. The sinusoid is multiplied by the envelope. A wave that is composed of a sinusoid multiplied by an envelope is said to have a carrier. So the carrier is the sinusoid itself, right? Okay. The carrier can move at its own velocity, which, surprisingly, is usually different than the velocity that the envelope is moving. Why I say surprisingly, well, some simple sort of intuition might have said, well, they better move at the same velocity, shouldn't they? Well, in fact, the truth is the opposite. More often than not, in fact, you have to try very hard to make them move at the same velocity, but more often than not, they move at different velocities. So the velocity at which the envelope is moving is called the group velocity. The velocity at which the carrier is moving is called the phase velocity. And right now, we'll just leave those like this. Later, we will actually derive them properly, and we will see how they come about and how they are defined. But I can say for now, without any proof, that what we wrote in geometrical optics, C over N, that is the phase velocity of the light. Okay. If you were to put an envelope on the light somehow, which is done in special lasers called mode-locked lasers, you can have a light wave that looks like this. It has an envelope. As it propagates, in those, the group velocity is generally different than the phase velocity of the light. Okay. Of course, I said earlier that periodic waves are not very interesting. Nevertheless, for educational and analysis purposes, they're simple. So therefore, we start with periodic waves when we analyze waves. And periodic are also known as harmonic waves. And of course, in a periodic wave, there's no envelope to speak of. And therefore, there's no group velocity to speak of, because the envelope is flat. There's no profile going anywhere. So the only thing you have is a sinusoidal disturbance moving with the phase velocity, right? Here you only have the carrier. So the only velocity to speak of is the phase velocity. That's a characteristic of the harmonic wave. And I will start putting some notation here. So the time, you can see the time as a running index here. And the horizontal axis, I will call it z. Okay, so we will stick to z as the axis of wave propagation for a while. Right. So now let's do some math. This is a harmonic wave, I can expect to describe it as a sinusoid. And the sinusoid, in order to characterize it, I need a number of quantities which have certain buzzwords. So we better start defining our buzzwords right now so we don't get confused when we refer to them later in the class. So the constant that goes in front of the sinusoid is called the amplitude. The reason I use E as a symbol for the constant is because electromagnetic waves are usually electric fields. We will see that later after we do Maxwell's equations. For now, this could be any symbol, actually. In fact, very quickly, I will revert to a different symbol. But in any case, this quantity that appears here is called the amplitude. Then the other quantity that we need to describe a sinusoid is the frequency. But now the frequency, we have to be a little bit careful, because there's two frequencies going on. You can see very clearly, you can think of this as a snapshot of the wave. If I take this picture and I freeze it, I will get something that looks like this. So in this snapshot, the axis is space coordinate, it is z. So the period that you observe here, the period that you observe in the spatial axis, it is called the wavelength. Okay, we saw that before. We did the definition of the wavelength in, I believe, lecture number one. Okay. Now, suppose I do like this. Suppose I fix my position somewhere on this axis, and I observe the value of the wave as it is passing by me. So now I'm fixed at a given z, and I observe the wave. What do I observe if I stand over here? I observe another sinusoid, don't I? Because if I'm sitting here, the wave that I will see will be oscillating. It will go in a sinusoidal fashion. It will oscillate from a positive value to a negative value. So that actually associates with the temporal frequency of the wave, for which we simply use the term frequency. So when we say frequency, we mean the temporal frequency. And some people use F. I prefer to use the symbol nu for that quantity. Finally, I have not defined my time axis yet. So when I'm looking at the oscillation, if I'm fixed and I look at the oscillation of the wave, at time zero, the wave might be absolute positive. In that case, it means the wave is a cosine. Or it may be zero. In that case, it means it is a sine. And how do I correct for this discrepancy? By adding a phase delay, right? By adding, for example, in this case, pi over 2. So this additional phase that I need to add in order to fix the origin of time is called the phase delay. And for a while, I will use the symbol phi for the phase delay. OK, so we define basically all the quantities that we need, except nu is not anywhere to be seen in this equation. What I've written instead is this expression z minus ct. And what is the meaning of this expression? Bottom.
Traveling wave.
It is a traveling wave. Or another way to put it is a traveling coordinate system. If I write we have no doubt where this is. That's a sinusoid. Now, that's a sinusoid in an axis of coordinates xi. OK? If I now say xi equals z minus ct, where t is time, what I have done is I've taken this axis and I've started moving it with respect to its rest position at t equals 0. So this is what I've done in the expression for the wave. I've put this traveling coordinate system into the sinusoid. And I don't really have the frequency in here, but you can see that time, the time variable, is in the expression for the sinusoid, so I can get the frequency very easily. And the way I get it is by observing that since the wave is periodic in the time domain, it will repeat one period later. So the period is the inverse of the frequency. So if I look at this expression over here, let me rewrite the wave. Okay. I can also write it I haven't done anything, just expanded the parentheses. So when this quantity becomes 2 pi or any integral multiple thereof, the wave will repeat, won't it? So that will happen when the time equals the period of the wave. Or another way to put it is that 2 pi over lambda times c over nu, where nu is the frequency, the inverse of the period, equals 2 pi. Of course, the pi goes away. And we derive something that we've seen before, c equals lambda nu. And that is what we use to call the dispersion relation. Okay. So this is how we connect the phase velocity of the wave with the wavelength and the frequency. And, okay, the phase delay is actually a very important property of waves, but it's not a really George, big deal. This is what I was saying before.
George?
Yes.
Why is it called a dispersion relation?
Yes. There's no dispersion to be seen here, isn't it? Isn't there? However, if I put, for example, an index of refraction, then the index of refraction is a function of lambda, right? So then you get dispersion. And of course, another case is this is the dispersion relation in free space. If you put boundary conditions on the wave, for example, if you confine it in a waveguide, the dispersion relation changes, right? I will not do this in this class, but that's another way where the wave becomes dispersive, right? So. Okay, so that's the explanation of the phase delay. I don't want to spend too much time. If at equals 0 you see this, this means the wave is a cosine, the phase delay is 0. And then, depending on what you see at t equals 0, you may have different phase delays. Now, the reason the phase delay is an important quantity is because I want you to look at it very carefully and tell me what you see. So, in the... Anybody want to volunteer what has happened here? I'm going to play this once again. How are the two different on the left and on the right? Okay, on the left, again, look at it very carefully. On the left, the two spherical waves, they're always bright together or dark together. So they oscillate, as we say, in phase. On the right, the two waves are out of phase. So if you look at it carefully, you will see that when one is bright, the other is dark, and vice versa. I'll play it again so you can see it. Okay, and because of this, again, I'm going to play it once again, and now don't look at the centers of the waves anymore, but look at the general patterns. You will see that the general patterns are actually different. They have the same general shape, but whether the pattern is dark or bright at any given instant actually depends on how the two waves started. So whether when we have, this is called the superposition, because I have waves originating from two sources simultaneously, when I have a superposition, the structure of the overall wave that I observe depends very strongly on the relative phase between the two sources in this case. Okay, so with that, I think I will stop and we will continue on Monday. And I will not post any new notes for Monday because I think we're far enough behind that we should catch up on Monday. What I would like to say is that it is about time to start the projects for the graduate class for 2710. So soon, basically by Thursday morning Boston time, and hopefully earlier, I will post in the website a list of possible projects and some instructions on what to do. And then basically what I would like you guys to do is spend the next week selecting your project and also contacting your mentors. Each project will be mentored by one of my graduate students, and some by me, some possibly, I don't know if Colin, you might be interested in mentoring one, but anyway, we'll figure out. Maybe some from Singapore, maybe not, anyway, so we will assign mentors to the projects and then we can get them started. The presentation is in May 6 or May 7, but anyway, the sooner we start, the better. So.